Hey guys, what's up? Been a while since I've done a study on the whiteboard, or at least a week or so, but anyways, we're going to be doing the study on figure of speech, and it's called hyperbole. And I've talked about a little bit about this in the past, but I want to go into deeper and deeper detail. And actually, I have a really long study that I put together for this, and a lot of my studies, I just try to go into a lot of detail, and it kind of prevents me from getting them out there because I print them out and it's like 10 or 20 pages or something that I'm going through. I'm trying to like perfect the notes and stuff, like prepare for the study. And I'm like, this is like too much. So I decided I'm going to try to break these down into parts, and they're still probably going to be long, even being broken down more. But this is just going to be an introduction to hyperbole, okay? And we'll go over some of the basics I've already talked about in the past, but even a little bit more detail. And so basically, hyperbole is a figure of speech, and basically what it is exaggeration. Okay, and we should all know pretty much what this is. It's pretty common. Use it a lot. Exaggeration. Make sure I spell that right. Oh, man. Okay. Exaggeration. We exaggerate a lot. And so if we're going to categorize different figures of speech, you know, figures of speech are like ways that we express ourselves with our words, and we use them in different ways than like their normal ways, phrases, to get an idea, expression across. And so hyperbole is exaggeration, and we can categorize different figures of speech in different categories, like similes and metaphors. They could be categorized under figures of comparison because they're used to compare things. Like, simile is a figure of speech where usually it's used a lot with the words as or like. So I'd say, you know, this person is like a dog, or something like that. You know, it's that would be like using a simile. And that's comparing, you know, a person to a dog, which isn't really a good comparison. It could be in a good way, I guess, if, you know, they were fast or something like that. As fast as a dog, fast like a dog, or something. I don't know. But anyways, that's a figure of comparison. So that's, a simile can be categorized under a figure of comparison. We got figures of humanization, where human attributes and likenesses are attributed to things, or even to God, where we have the figure of speech anthropomorphism. And so we see verses where it talks about God having hands, like Jesus said, you know, that he'll keep his sheep, you know, in his hand, and, you know, they'll be in the Father's hand. And that's just, you know, in that sense, we're not concerned about a literal physical hand here. It's really just expressing that you're secure with God. Okay, you're in his hand. It doesn't mean his physical, literal hand. Okay, you know, Father, God is spirit. Okay, God is spirit. And so that's a figure of humanization. That's attributing, you know, something of a human to God. Anthropomorphism, the category of humanization or personification, or that'd be another figure of speech. But anyways, we're going to categorize hyperbole under the category of illusion. Okay. Illusion. Because it's saying more than what is meant, okay? So it's kind of like bending reality in a way, okay? Illusion. So hyperbole, basically it means exaggeration. We use it a lot, and it's under the category of illusion, okay? Now, I could say that we use hyperbole all the time, and when I said that, I actually used hyperbole in that sentence, okay? Because do we use hyperbole all the time? I mean, literally, do we don't sleep, we don't eat, we just use hyperbole night and day, Okay, we don't even breathe. We just use hyperbole all the time. No, okay, it's an exaggeration. We use it a lot, okay? Most people could probably understand what I meant by that. But when we come into interpreting the Bible, we can see that there are disagreements on passages where hyperbole is used, and there's disagreements whether hyperbole is being used. Is it a figure of speech just to express an idea, or is it something that's literal that needs to be taken hard literally? Okay. There are some people who might want to go through the Bible and say that everything's hyperbole or something, you know, and that's not right. And then there's people who don't want to, see hyperbole in a lot of things. So, you know, they'll try to take everything literally. We really need to try to understand the Bible in its context as it's meant to be understood. So that's, you know, the struggle. That's what we work towards. But I want to give you a bunch of modern examples of hyperbole, so if you don't really understand yet, maybe you can understand if I read some of these. I said we use hyperbole all the time, okay? So we don't usually literally use it all the time, but a lot. So that's exaggerating, that's hyperbole, that's saying more than what is literally meant. And that's kind of like the definition of hyperbole, saying more than what is literally meant. And I'll go ahead and write that down too, okay? So it's saying more than what is literally meant. Okay. And anyways. So hyperbole, saying more than what is literally meant. Let's get this pointer ready, I guess. I don't know how I'll be using that, but okay. So I said we use hyperbole all the time. That's exaggerating, okay? I could say I've got a million things to do today. We use the word, like, million a lot to over-exaggerate things, okay? I've got a million things to do today. Do I really have a million things to do today? No, absolutely not. Okay, but that's exaggerating. I had a lot of things to do today. You know, I walked like a million miles. I worked like a million hours. Okay. We use that the word a million a lot because that's just like a huge, huge number. And we just throw that out there. We know that, you know, when someone says that, we know that they're exaggerating. They're using hyperbole, okay? And so a lot of these I looked up online and stuff to get ideas, and some of them I've just kind of came up with, like the using hyperbole all the time. I just kind of came up with that. Like, we use it so much, and I think the more that we study this, the more that we're going to catch ourselves using it. And it's going to help us to see it in Scripture as well. And so this is very needful, you know, to do these figures of speech studies. I always say that, but, you know, I'm scared to death. We say that a lot, you know, I was scared to death, or whatever. Okay, well, did you die? No. Okay. So when we say we're scared to death, you know, we're really, really scared. Okay. But we're not scared to death, literally. Okay. Exaggeration's being used. Hyperbole's being used. This Bible weighs a ton. This book weighs a ton. Okay, actually, this is really light, but even, you know, heavy books, I could take the heaviest book that I got and say, this book weighs a ton. It doesn't weigh a ton. Okay. It's heavy, but it doesn't weigh a ton, literally. So, it's exaggeration. I'm so hungry, I could eat a horse. Okay, that's a fun one. So, exaggerations can be funny a lot of times, too, because they're so, like, absurd, like, you know, it's exaggerating so much. I'm so hungry I could eat a horse. That's a very, very hungry person. Okay. Now, a horse is a pretty big animal, so if we understand it that way, you know, he's so hungry he could eat a whole horse, and wow, I mean, that's disgusting, but it's, you know, some people actually eat horse meat. That's kind of crazy, but anyways, I could sleep for a year. I could sleep for a year. That would be nice, wouldn't it? I do like sleep, but you know, you don't get much done when you're sleeping. But sometimes, you know, it's needful. It's needful every day. But nobody really wants to sleep for a year, okay? Literally, that's a long time. That's missing out on a year of your life, okay? So that's exaggeration. The path went on forever, okay? I was walking down a trail. It just went on forever. Huge exaggeration there, okay? Saying more than what is literally meant. Okay. I must have jumped a mile, or he must have jumped a mile, okay? He must have jumped a mile. Now that would be a far jump. That's, I mean, that would break some records. I don't know if anybody could beat that, but I would think that person's, like, not human or something if they literally jumped a mile. Okay, he was so big, he used a tree trunk for a toothpick. Okay, that's getting pretty creative now. There's some pretty creative ones on here, but that one's pretty big. He was so big, he used a tree trunk for a toothpick. And so some people might try to break these things down too, and in scripture I can see it where they would say, you know, he is so big that he used a tree trunk for a toothpick. And they could say something like, well, he had like a really big toothpick or something. But really, the exaggeration is expressing how big the person is, you know. So there can be these things where we can kind of get off on different things, focus on the wrong things. So the exaggeration, he was so big he used a tree trunk for a toothpick, is basically that this person was huge. It has nothing really to do with a toothpick or nothing to do with a tree trunk, okay. So you see that in scripture a lot. We can focus on the wrong things. Like I said, when Jesus said, you know, my sheep are kept in my hand and in my Father's hand, we're not really talking about hands here and stuff. It's this idea that you're secure with God, okay? That's what is meant. So don't focus, you know, we have to learn what to focus on and how to interpret these things, and it takes time and takes studying and stuff. But we have to study these figures of speech. We really have to understand the nature of the English language. So, the next one is really funny and bizarre and disgusting and gross and everything, but I read this online and I had to add this. This coffee, and I'm actually drinking coffee, but that coffee is good, but this exaggeration says, this coffee tastes like an old man has been heated to render out the earwax. Yeah, that's gross. Okay. So it's like that coffee tastes really, really bad, okay? And the focus isn't on an old man. The focus isn't on earwax, or it isn't on heat. It's just this saying that, man, that coffee is nasty, okay? That is gross. Unless you like, you know, earwax from an old man or whatever. That's not really my thing. But now, sometimes literally is used before a hyperbole to add humor. So I could say the same thing that I just said again, but I could say, this coffee literally tastes like an old man has been heated to render out the earwax, okay? And somebody could be like, well, that's literal. See, it says literally. It says literally it tastes like an old man has been heated to render out the earwax. But literally is just added to add humor, okay? It's not meant to make this hyperbole to be understood as literal, okay? So, how do we identify? So, I'll write these down. Just some basics, okay? And we'll say, identifying factors. Okay, what are the identifying factors of hyperbole? Okay. So, the identifying factors are, first of all, silence. No, just kidding. I hope that this will all get on the camera. I can zoom in or something if I have to. It's kind of small. I don't know if you'll be able to see it very well. But first of all, one of the identifying factors if it's literally impossible. Okay, like I jumped to the moon. I jumped so high, I jumped to the moon. Okay, that's literally impossible. Okay, so obviously I didn't jump to the moon. Okay, I just jumped really high. And you know, some people try to say, I'll talk about later on, well, some people will use a hyperbole, like say, like I jumped to the moon, and they'll think that it's an exaggeration, but they'll still think like I jumped, you know, into the stratosphere, or I jumped, you know, above the clouds or something. It's like, no, okay, I might have just jumped like a few feet, or, you know, 4 foot or something, you know, whatever is literally possible. Okay, so some people get confused about that. You know, an exaggeration, it's usually, you know, it's a big exaggeration, a huge exaggeration. Okay, like these things that I've said, like, you know, he jumped a mile or something. That's a huge exaggeration. Okay. So, one of the identifying factors of hyperbole is that it's literally impossible. The next identifying factor is drop the eraser. Okay. The next identifying factor for hyperbole is if there seems to be contradictions, okay, then we could be dealing with a hyperbole. And we're going to see that that does happen in Scripture. There are places where there could be contradictions. If somebody takes a hyperbole literally, then we're going to run into contradictions in Scripture. You know, we can run into some serious errors by taking hyperbole literally, okay? Not every verse that uses hyperbole, if somebody, you know, misinterprets it, is always some kind of a deadly, you know, heretical interpretation, okay? I would still correct somebody if I believe that they're wrong, and I say, you know, this is hyperbole, you're wrong. But there are some verses that we should seriously, you know, stand hard on understanding correctly. And we'll go over those, okay? And I'm going to dedicate part of the study just to looking at these verses that could cause contradictions if you take them literally. Okay, now finally, the third identifying factor is kind of sloppy now. Okay. Let's see if you can see that. It's probably so tiny you can't see much, but maybe I can zoom in. Okay. So, the third identifying factor is look for words or phrases like no one, nothing, all, everyone, or everything. Like these all-inclusive words or phrases, okay? You know, like, you know, I hate to get into this again, but it's just the first thing that kind of came to my mind, like the Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump. You know, some of Hillary Clinton's rallies, like no one showed up, okay? No one. No one showed up to Hillary Clinton's rallies, okay? Now, is that literally true? No. Okay, maybe like 100 people showed up compared to like 20,000 or whatever that came to Trump's rallies, okay? no one went to Hillary Clinton's rallies. Okay, that's not literally true, but it's hyperbole. Okay, compared to Trump's, it was so minuscule. Okay, and I said earlier, we use exaggeration all the time. All. Okay, so no one, nothing, all, everyone, everything. So the identifying factors of hyperbole is, if it's literally impossible, it's probably hyperbole. If there seems to be contradictions, we could be dealing with a hyperbole. If there are words or phrases like no one, nothing, all, everyone, or everything, it could be hyperbole. Okay, so those are the biggest things to look for when we're dealing with this. So hyperbole is exaggeration. It's in the category of figures of illusion. It's a figure of speech, and it's saying more than what is literally meant. Okay. Now we're going to get into some scripture. And this is going to be pretty basic, but I think it's good for a beginning. And I want to say that I'm not going to go into the background of a lot of these verses and stuff and the context, because that's kind of beyond the scope of the study, and you know, that takes a lot more preparation and stuff, so I can't give the best, you know, background of the verses and everything, but I'll mention what I can, I guess. But we're going to talk about this phrase. Okay, maybe I'll use a different color just to have fun, I guess. I'll use blue. This is going to be up to heaven, basically. And there's different variations of this phrase. Okay. Up to heaven. We're going to see how this phrase is used. It's hyperbole. Used as hyperbole in a lot of scriptures. And I'm sure there's probably even way more than what I've got listed. And I'm not sure how to do this, but maybe I'll write down the verses for one. The first one's going to be Deuteronomy chapter 1, verse 28. Let's see. And I've got about 9 or so. My goal is kind of to get like 9 or 10 verses to go over in each one of these parts of the study, but we'll see what happens. Okay, so Deuteronomy chapter 1 verse 28 says, "Whither shall we go up? Our brethren have discouraged our hearts, saying, the people is greater and taller than we. The cities are great and walled up to heaven. And moreover, we have seen the sons of the Anakims there." Okay, so this is walled up to heaven. Okay. Let's see here. I don't know how I want to do this. I don't know if I want to write down the phrase every time, but it looks like that's what I'm going to be doing. So, this is walled up to heaven, Deuteronomy chapter 1, verse 28. Okay, literally, are there cities walled up to heaven? Okay, you know, past the clouds and wherever. Okay, no. Okay, they're really tall people, they had great cities, they had really tall walls, really tall buildings. Okay, and it could just be even to express the, just the size of the people, to express their great height. But actually, that's what I should do. Maybe I'll write what the figure is trying to express. Okay. So that's what I'll do. To express their great height. Okay. Okay. I'm not even going to put "to express" because I'll just be using that a lot. So. Um, great height, okay? And then I'll just put to express here. So we'll see this phrase up to heaven. We're going to see how it's used to express different things in different verses. Okay. So it's a hyperbole. Their walls weren't literally up to heaven. They were just really tall. Okay. It's to express great height. Now let's go to the next one. 1 Samuel chapter 5 verse 12. Okay, 1 Samuel chapter 5 verse 12. It says, "And the men that died not were smitten with the emerods." And I've read from, you know, translations or commentaries and stuff that the emerods were like tumors or a disease or something like that. So the men that didn't die were smitten with a disease or something, and the cry of the city went up to heaven. The cry of the city went up to heaven. And I was thinking this is interesting because, first of all, you know, what's a city? You know, is it the geographical location? Like if I said the city of industry, you know, which I live in, it's really more of like a village or something, a small town. But we could say the city of Chicago. What is the city of Chicago? Like on a map, it's like a geographical area, okay? So in a way, this is like a figure of speech as well. And I'm not sure exactly what it is. It could be a metonymy or synecdoche. But anyways, we'll go over those in the future. But does a city cry? Okay, a city's, you know, kind of like a like non-tangible kind of thing. No. It's the people in the city that cried. Okay, their cry went up to heaven. Did their cry go up to heaven? How can a cry go up to heaven? That's like, a cry is not like something like tangible, again, okay? Unless we're talking about like tears or something like that, but just in general, their cry went up to heaven. You know, that's a hyperbole. Okay. So it's the greatness of the cry. Okay. It's just greatness of the cry. So, you know, there's the people in the city. Their cry went up to heaven. They cried greatly. Okay. Very sorrowful, very agonizing. Okay. Now, let's go to 2 Chronicles chapter 28, verse 9. 2 Chronicles chapter 8, verse 29, which says, "But a prophet of the Lord was there, whose name was Oded, and he went out before the host that came to Samaria, and said unto them, Behold, because the Lord God of your fathers was wroth with Judah, he hath delivered them into your hand, and ye have slain them in a rage that reacheth up to heaven." A rage that reacheth up to heaven. Okay. Is to express the intensity of the rage. So again, you know, just like the city's cry, you know, a cry is not really something that's like physical and stuff like that, you know, and neither is rage, okay? But we see rage up to heaven, okay? The rage was very intense. The intensity of the rage. Now, so far, we probably couldn't see too many people arguing with these and trying to take them literally, but I mean, I'm sure it's possible. Now, we'll look at Ezra chapter 9, verse 6. Ezra chapter 9, verse 6, which says, "And said, O my God, I am ashamed and blush to lift up my face to thee, my God. For our iniquities are increased over our head, and our trespass is grown up into the heavens. Okay. So this is to express the enormity of their sin. Enormity of their sin. Okay. It said, our iniquities have increased over our head. Okay. Obviously, that's not literal. Okay. Again, iniquities is like a non-tangible thing, pretty much. And, you know, over our head, that's, you know, a figure of speech. And our trespass is grown up into the heavens. Hyperbole. Now, Psalm 107, chapter, or verse 26. It says, they mount up to the heaven. They go down again to the depths. Their soul is melted because of trouble. In Psalms, you know, we know plenty of figures of speech are used, you know, as poetic writing. But, so, they mount up to the heaven. They go down again to the depths. Their soul is melted because of trouble. Okay. Now, I think what we're talking about here is waves. Maybe I should go back a little bit more. Psalm 107. What are we talking about here? Psalm 107, 26. Okay. Yeah, so you see, verse number 25, it says, for he commandeth and raiseth the stormy wind, which lifteth up the waves thereof. And then it says, they mount up to the heavens, they go down again to the depths, their soul is melted because of trouble. Okay, so we're talking about the waves. You know, the waves actually go up to the heavens, literally. No, that's literally impossible. Okay. Unless it was, you know, some kind of miracle act of God or something. But that's not what we're talking about here. So, it's to express the violence of a storm and waves, as we say, mountain high. Okay? Violence of the storm. Now, let's go to Isaiah chapter 14, verse 13. Isaiah chapter 14, verse 13. For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. Oh boy. So this is a controversial verse here. And I was kind of looking into this, actually. And this is, you know, for another study, but a lot of people use this, and I've used it myself, to talk about Satan, saying that, you know, what I want to say is that, first of all, 100%, we need to understand this in its historical context, okay? It's talking about the king of Babylon. Now, if somebody wants to say that it's a type of Satan, or, you know, it's a alluding to Satan, to the fall of Satan, you know, that could be debatable, okay? I'm not really sure where I stand on that. I've used it before, and I've read somewhere, and I kind of agree that it doesn't really hurt the doctrine of Satan if we don't use this passage. And there's one in Ezekiel, too. So there's one in Isaiah, one in Ezekiel. You know, there's one in Ezekiel where he says, you were my cherub, you know, you were in the Garden of Eden and stuff. You know, those are all figures of speech, too. Okay? And I'll have to go over that in another study. But could it be alluding to the fall of Satan and stuff? It could be. But, you know, there's other verses in the New Testament that talk about the pride of Satan. There's other verses that talk about the fall. And so, one way or the other, if we just use these passages completely in their historical context, where, you know, the one in Isaiah is talking about the king of Babylon, the one in Ezekiel is talking about the king of Tyre, I think that's what it was. You know, we're not really hurting anything. But So, but we do need to understand that that's 100% what it's talking about first, okay? But, you know, I think it doesn't really hurt to say that, you know, he was a type of Satan or whatever, and we can use things like that. But anyways, maybe that was confusing, but like Isaiah 14:13, for thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. Okay, this is to express the pride of Lucifer, okay? Express the great pride, okay? So, you know, like I said earlier, too, how people can focus on the wrong things, like they can focus on in Ezekiel, they can focus on Eden, and they can be like, well, see, this is talking about the Garden of Eden. Or, you know, and here they can focus on, you know, the throne of God and ascending into heaven and above the stars of God. So they can think that this is really talking about, you know, where the throne of God is in the spiritual realm or whatever, and get the focus off on stuff. This is all just stuff used to express the greatness of the pride of Lucifer in this artistic way, okay? So trying to break these things down into all these little details, which we do, and sometimes that's beneficial, and sometimes we need to do that, but there's a lot of times that we don't, and we just kind of need to take a step back and say, okay, I've said in my heart, I will ascend into heaven, okay? The greatness of the pride, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God, okay? His pride is really great. And, you know, I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation on the sides of the north, okay? This guy has really high pride, okay? That's all we need to really take from that verse. Okay, we don't need to try to, you know, take all this stuff really literally and this hard literal interpretation and everything. Okay, I heard that John Calvin, who was a heretic, probably, you know, in hell, because he didn't really have the fruit of Jesus, but he had some good commentaries and stuff. But, you know, I read that he's one of the people that took, like, a hardcore stance against people using these passages to be used for Satan, okay, basically. And it's like, I wish that I could take like a hardcore stance one way or the other, but I'm just saying, you know, we do have to understand it in its historical context. We have to understand hyperbole, not to focus on all these little details in this verse, but get the bigger picture, okay? Anyway, moving on. Jeremiah chapter 51, verse 9. Jeremiah, the weeping prophet, right? Jeremiah's a pretty awesome book. Okay. Jeremiah chapter 51, verse 9. We would have healed Babylon, but she is not healed. Forsake her. Okay. And it's interesting, too. Babylon, a city, it's described as a female. Her, and you see this a lot and stuff, so I mean, these are figures of speech and stuff, you know. Like, there could be somebody who could be like, well, no, Babylon's a female, it says, like, her and stuff like this, but, no, we need to understand what's really meant here. And though she should fortify the height of her strength, yet from me shall spoilers come unto her, saith the Lord. Okay. So at the beginning, I missed that. It says, though Babylon should mount up to heaven. Okay, so it's the pride of Babylon. The pride of Babylon as a city. Now, this will be the last one. This will be Matthew. So we're actually getting into the words of Jesus now, and we're going to see how Jesus loved to use hyperbole, and I'll do a whole part just on Jesus using hyperbole. Matthew chapter 11 verse 23 says, and thou, Capernaum, which art exalted unto heaven, shall be brought down to hell. For if the mighty works which have been done in thee had been done in Sodom, it would have remained until this day. Okay. Now, I took this commentary from Bible Hub. It might have been Ellicott's commentary, I don't know. But I thought it was pretty good. So, because I needed to understand this verse a little bit more, too. So, he says, the phrase, which art exalted to heaven. You know, Jesus said, Capernaum, which art exalted to heaven, thou shalt be brought down to hell. So, which art exalted to heaven. This is an expression used to denote great privileges. Okay? Great privileges. Oh, I spelled that right. I'm looking right at it. Okay. Great privileges. He meant that they were especially favored with instruction. The city was prosperous. It was signally favored by its wealth. Most of all, it was signally favored by the presence, the preaching, and the miracles of the Lord Jesus Christ. Here he spent a large portion of his time in the early part of his ministry, and in Capernaum, and it's his neighborhood, he performed his chief miracles, okay, in Capernaum. So Jesus said, thou art exalted unto heaven, very privileged, but shalt be brought down to hell. This does not mean that all the people would go to hell, and I could see some people trying to interpret like that, okay. But anyways, but that the city, which had flourished so prosperously, would lose its prosperity and occupy the lowest place among cities. The word hell is used here, not to denote a place of punishment in the future world, but a state of desolation and destruction. And it stands in contrast with the word heaven, as their being exalted to heaven did not mean that the people would all be saved or dwell in heaven, so their being brought down to hell refers to the desolation of the city. Their privileges, honors, wealth, etc. would be taken away, and they would sink as low among cities as they had been before exalted. This has been strictly fulfilled in the wars between the Jews and the Romans. Chorazin, Bethsaida, Capernaum, etc., were so completely desolated that it is difficult to determine their former situation. It is not to be denied also that he threatened future punishment on those who rejected him. The truth included, or inculcated, the truth inculcated here is that those who are especially favored will be punished according if they abuse their privileges. Okay, so Capernaum exalted up to heaven, you have great privileges. Very great privileges. So, I'll go ahead and I'll circle these verses. Maybe you can see them a little better. And that's all the verses I'm going to go over for this one. I hope it was really helpful. It's helped me. I learned a lot. Learned more just going over this right now. And I just needed to get this out and get it started. But I'm really glad I have this whiteboard and stuff. I think it helps a little bit. I don't know. Maybe I'll zoom in. I don't know how good it's going to be, but maybe you can see a little better. I want to take a screenshot or something, or pause it, write these things down. So yeah, I probably got at least six or more parts of the study that I want to do. Some other things that I'm going to go over. Or, as I said, the fact that Jesus used hyperbole, and those are some pretty, really important ones. I mean, all scripture is important, but there's more contention with some of those, I guess. And I'm going to show how some verses where there could be contradictions, so we can solve contradictions, apparent contradictions, by understanding hyperbole. I want to show just various hyperbole, just miscellaneous. I want to go over some other phrases, kind of like up to heaven. That's probably what I'll do next. It'll be pretty easy and simple. So there's just these phrases that are used over and over again, stuff that we would even use today, that we can see in scripture. And it's interesting how, I mean, this phrase up to heaven, or phrases that are very similar to it, are used in so many different ways. It's used to express great height. It's used to express the greatness of the cry of the city. It's used to express the intensity of the rage, the enormity of their sins, the violence of the storm, the great pride of Lucifer, the pride of Babylon, the great privileges. So, the great privileges of the city of Capernaum, right? So very interesting, and I'm sure that's used in other places. I'd like to see if you could find where it's used in other ways, a phrase that's similar to this, you know, and I'm sure in the future I'll go back over. And this is on the forum. You can go to the forum, kjvforum.com, go to Bible study, go to hermeneutics. Actually, it's not Bible study, I think. Go to hermeneutics, then go to figures of speech, and then go to hyperbole. I think it's on page 2, and I'll be working on making the menus, you know, more accessible and everything. But anyways, so show how Jesus used hyperbole, solving contradictions, just more miscellaneous, more phrases. And also, I want to do one on some of the times where hyperbole is used that can be like deadly interpretations if people take it wrong. I've seen them taken wrong before. You know, ones that I think are the most severe that we really need to understand correctly. So, let's see. I think I've talked too much for now. And I don't know when I'll get these other studies out, but hopefully sooner than later. And I have plenty of other ones too. And once we get done with hyperbole, I'll move on to another figure of speech. But yeah, this is common. We use it a lot, and even though we do, we probably don't realize it a lot, but we need to learn how to catch it and understand it and catch it, and that'll help us catch it in Scripture, and it's going to help us greatly. It's helped me greatly so far, and it's continuing to. So, anyways, thanks for watching, and I guess I'll pray. Thank you, God, for this day so much, Lord God. It's a wonderful, beautiful day. Thank you that Trump's inaugurated. He's in the White House now, and I pray that you'll have blessings upon our country, America, and just throughout the world, God. I pray that you'll bless brothers and sisters who watch this video, God, help them to understand these things and see it more in Scripture. Help draw us closer together as we look towards you, God. We look towards heaven, and we want to be with you. Lord, help us to give us the strength and courage and boldness to go out and to witness and to preach your message uncompromisingly, God. I pray that, 2017, that great, great, wonderful things will happen for your kingdom, God, that more people will be saved and converted and come to the truth and a greater understanding of you, Lord God. And, you know, I even pray for those people that I believe, you know, are false teachers. And somehow, God, I pray that they would just be turned around. That's, you know, however, so just speak to them, work on them with the Holy Spirit, God, and draw them closer to you and open their understanding and illuminate the Scriptures. God, and I pray for those who are struggling right now, brothers and sisters who talk to me. You know, we all have our struggles, God. We need encouragement. We need miracles in our life. And we confide in you. And you are our Lord and our God. And we thank you for sending your Son Jesus to die for us always, Lord. May we remember that. The sacrifice that was made for us, and be grateful and thankful for everything, Lord, even through our struggles. Help us to continue just to focus on you and not get distracted by this world, Lord. I thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So, thanks guys for watching again. And just a struggle sometimes for me to focus to get these studies done, but I really do hope to plan to get a lot more done, get in some kind of routine. I've said that for a while, but we'll see. So, I guess I'm going to end this video here, and God bless.